So shall we start? So good afternoon, everyone. The title of my lecture today is Walter Benjamin's Media Theory from the Oratic Age to the End of History. Walter Benjamin's critical project is based on three main conceptual constructs, constituting bedrocks of his media theory. There is the first set of concepts, which is medium and apparat. The second set of concepts is aura and authenticity. I repeat, the first set of concepts is medium and apparat, that I will explain later. The second set of concepts, or is aura and authenticity, and the third set of concepts is reproduction and reproducibility. Before delving into the discussion of these concepts, I would like to remind you that the study of media text is multidimensional, and all theories we have presented so far focus on a set of dimensions, while they may neglect other dimensions. Normally, the attempt to engage with issues arising from one single text is a very complicated matter by a number of factors. These include, for instance, the context of production, where this text is produced, both immediate and institutional context, explaining also the identity of the author. I'm here trying to explain to you the difficulties that we face when we are studying, you know, a media text, because all what we have seen, these are not comprehensive approaches, but they rather focus on one set of dimensions, one dimension or two, or a set of dimensions, but they neglect other dimensions. So there is no comprehensive, all that is inclusive approach that we can include everything in. Always there is this limitation of neglecting some aspects of analysis. So the context of production is one factor, or is one parameter, both immediate and institutional context, explaining the identity of the author and the social structures involved in the shaping, that is, of the text and the author's perspective, the historical lapse between the author and the present time, that's also important in the study of a media text, the plurality of meanings that traverse the text, the ideological implications and textual openness, the technologies of reproduction that constitute the medium of textual forms and their circulation. The discursive formations that institutionalize the textual practice, such as textual canons, for instance. In other words, it's very hard to delimit the text as a closed entity. Most of the texts are, you know, they are open-ended. Even if they have a full stop, but they are still open. They are hypertexts or intertexts, in that they, that is, open on other texts and other discursive formations on other contexts, and they are traversed by different ideologies. After the short introduction of the difficulties, or introduction to the difficulties of dealing with theory as a comprehensive approach to the work of art, we move to deal with the first set of media concepts in Benjamin's project: medium and apparent. What does he mean by this term, this heuristic term, apparent? Why not just, because the word apparent is derived from the word apparatus. Good. That is, apparent is a heuristic term for understanding human experience in its interaction with technology. What does this mean? It means it is both the medium of technology and the medium of perception involved in interaction with each other. So when we speak about the parrot, we are speaking about the interaction of the medium of technology and the medium of perception. It is the sensory experience that is as it is involved with technical mediums. One of the bedrocks of Benjamin's media theory is the idea that human experience is always configured, shaped, and organized by different forms of material, technical, and discursive mediation that change through history. Our social identities are modeled and remodeled by the change of technology. Our perceptions, our perceptual skills are modeled and remodeled by the change of technology. Radio programs structure our minds differently from cinema or television programs. Each medium configures and organizes our bodily perceptual skills in a particular manner. That is, you know, the heart or the center of Benjamin's media theory. Benjamin was convinced that our human sensory experience, that is, the forms and rhythms of our perception, the extension and the coordinates of the visible, the audible, the tactile, and so on, had a history modeled by the different ways technical mediums were acting on us. Configuring and organizing what he calls in his essay the work of art in the age of its technological reproducibility, the medium of perception. History is acting, the history of technology has been acting on our medium of perception. So the question that we are going to ask here with Benjamin, these perceptual skills that we have, are they natural or are they historical, acquired throughout history? That's the big question here that we face, you know, with Benjamin. Benjamin's media theory is not normally concerned primarily with the study of media content or representations or systems of production or ownership, but with the study of the artistic, epistemic, and political implications of the changes in the medium of perception produced by historically changing material and technical configurations. Benjamin's theory is not a study of apparatus, but a study of perceptual experience influenced or determined by media mechanism. Such media theory is therefore basically connected to an aesthetics that studies the historical transformations of a sensory experience that is always somehow technically mediated. Benjamin regarded cinema as the most important subject matter for such an aesthetics, since it showed the clearest way how during the first decades of the 20th century, the medium of perception had been entirely reorganized by a new generation of technical mediums. So much so that the very idea of an apparatus-free immediate reality had become, as Benjamin says, the blue flower in the land of technology. So a reality which is not mediated by media apparatus is the blue flower in the land of technology. It doesn't exist. So our reality, that is, especially, that is in this, in the last decades, or in the 21st century, it is all of it apparatus-mediated reality. There is hardly any apparatus-free mediated reality. Very hard nowadays to speak about a social subject who has access that is, who has access to a media-free reality. Very hard to speak about a social subject who has, you know, access to a media-free reality. Someone who neither listens to radios, nor watches television, nor yet reads newspapers, nor uses mobile phones. Cut off from that is media apparatuses. Very hard. Even in the mountains, they may use mobile phones. So it's not enough to analyze the media content, but also the medium and its effect on human perception. The different material and technical articulations of the environment, the milieu, the atmosphere in which perception takes place. The idea that perception has a history and that such a history is determined by the way in which technical mediums keep on reorganizing the medium of perception is at the center of Benjamin's essay, The Work of Art in the Age of Its Technological Reproducibility. Benjamin's thesis of historicity, because here, remember, he speaks about history working on our sensorium, or that is perceptual apparatus or perceptual media. Benjamin's thesis of historicity of perception is underpinned by the assumption that human collectives' modes of survival changes over long historical periods. Their cultures, political systems, and economic means of survival. So too does their mode of perception. History doesn't only change our political systems, our cultures, our societies, our means of survival, our economies, but it also changes our perceptions to these economies and political systems and, you know, social fabrics. The way in which human perception is organized, the medium in which it occurs, is conditioned not only by nature, but by history. Look back on mythology. Look back on mythology and you will immediately grasp the difference in perception between the primitive societies and modern information societies. Now we watch Spider-Man, perhaps for fun. But the rise of Spider-Man in primitive societies could have turned him into a divinity. That is what, you know, if you notice what was real or realistic in the past or in the millennia of time in the past, now, of course, is looked at as the work of the fantastic. Benjamin believed that the history of art produced in different styles required different sensory experience from the human body, different perceptual modes. For example, there is a distinction to be drawn between a human gaze on artistic objects from distant position and a gaze instead at objects in a condition of closeness, like watching a video game on a mobile screen. So the work of perception, that you make when you are in a gallery or in a museum watching or looking at a piece of painting is not the same work of perception that you do when you are watching a video game on a mobile screen. That's completely different. So the perceptual modes change, you know, depending again on the styles, you know, of the works of art presented to us. For Benjamin, the historicity of perception has to be framed in a materialist perspective. Remember that he's Marxist. Benjamin also is Marxist, so he frames this, you know, this historicity of perception in a materialist perspective, studying the economic conditions of perceptual modes. And this example is found also in Karl Marx, who in a section of the Economic and Philosophical Manuscripts of 1844, titled Private Property in Communism, he commented on how private property had produced an exclusive focus on the sense of having. That is, private property as an economic system has produced, you know, a perceptual mode with a focus on the sense of having, possession, that is, possessing things, or the sense of possession. While communism, with the transcendence of private property, could be seen as a complete emancipation of all human senses. Though, you know, I don't agree, you know, with this last argument that, you know, transcendence of private property is that it emancipates our senses. This seems to be a little bit idealistic in the postmodern social context. According to this view, the passage from private property to communism could therefore be interpreted as a change in the forms of perception and as a confirmation that our sensory experience is not natural, but historically acquired. Benjamin, in this respect, quoted Marx in his unfinished collection of writings, titled again, Arcade's Project. He argues that our five senses, this is Benjamin's words, our five senses are a labor of the entire history of the world down to the present. So our five senses is a label, or that is, our sensory experience is a label of the entire history of the world down to the present. It's historically, you know, acquired. They're not just natural gifts, but hereditary labor stored in our genetics. Thus, Benjamin investigates, and I cite him again, the question whether people's visual impressions are determined only by natural constants or additionally by historical variables. As you may notice, Benjamin's project deals with the historicity of perception from a double perspective. On the one hand, he analyzes the changes in perception caused by a series of technical apparatus, photography, cinema, daily newspapers, street advertising, the telephone and radio, mediums that had become widespread during the first three decades of the 20th century. On the other hand, he looks for the first signs of these changes in the technical and material culture of the 19th century, excavating the media archives of Paris. Look at our urban space. If we contemplate a little bit our urban space, the fragments of our urban space, constituting furniture, decorations, private and public lighting systems, architectural designs in glass and steel, boulevards, shopping malls, spaces of commodity display, such as shop windows, department stores, and world exhibitions. All of them are technical and material articulations reorganizing our perception. It's a new urban configuration of the medium of our perception, that urban space. So Benjamin's aesthetic media theory is therefore based on the observation that the human apparatus of perception has been gradually exposed to the action of a new generation of technical apparatus that has completely reorganized the medium of perception. The use of the term apparat, according to Antonio Soumaini, and I will give you the title of his article by the end, he indicates both the sensory and the technical apparatuses involved in the different forms of technically mediated experience. This use, he says, you can also find in Sigmund Freud, who discusses the relations between our perceptual apparatus and all the forms of auxiliary apparatuses we have invented for the improvement or intensification of our sensory functions, such as spectacles. Just look at those who wear spectacles. Those who wear spectacles, they will understand how their, you know, their perception depends on this new, that is, technical medium that they use, you know, or this, that is, medium that, or this apparatus that they use, you know, to see with. The visual impressions they acquire when they wear spectacles. Sigmund Freud, as I say, discusses the relations between our perceptual apparatus and all the forms of auxiliary apparatuses we've invented to improve or intensify our sensory functions. Spectacles, photography, photographic cameras, ear trumpets, and the mystic writing pad. It's all of it a history of... So what are these auxiliary apparatuses create, that is produced or manufactured by technology? They all represent a history of predisposing the human sensory organs to the encounter with technology. It's not an easy story, ladies and gentlemen. It's not an easy story because I still remember one of the anthropologists. He's a classic, but his ideas are still pertinent to nowadays, you know, technologized social context. When he speaks about, that is, the difference in evolution between biology and, you know, the development in technology. He says that we are not biologically equipped to cope up with the technological progress. And so we keep stumbling over these technological, you know, inventions. Because the progress of technology has happened overnight. It's very rapid. It's a rapid rise. Whereas the evolution of biology, it takes time. It is very slow. And so, to what extent are we really biologically equipped, you know, to cope up with this technological advancement? So, if we, that is, if we follow the Darwinian perspective telling us that the function creates the organ, these computers that we use, these mobiles that we use, and these television sets that we use, are we biologically, that is, equipped to use them? That's the question. So Sigmund Freud says that, of course, they have, that is, an impact on our perceptual systems, but to what extent are they really changing our biology? And if they are changing our biology, they are not changing it fast. We are still having a lot of, you know, problems with coping with it. I'm speaking here from a biological perspective. To give you another example that this man Morris speaks about is that he says that naturally speaking, we are animals. Of course, we are speaking animals or thinking animals, but we are, that is, we share with animals a lot of instincts. And he says that in the animal world, when there is a fight between members of the same species, they don't kill each other. When the opponent is defeated, he signals his defeat. Like in, take the example of dogs when they are fighting. Dogs, when they fight, the defeated dog, what does he do? Or what does it do it runs, or it crouches down and it puts its tails between its legs. That is the signal of defeat for a dog. Of course, human beings have created many signals of defeat. Many signals. And the latest signals that we know about is that one day, you know, raise the white flag. But we have created a technology that doesn't see any white flag. There are nations who can shell bombs from thousands and thousands of kilometers. Jet fighters do not see any white flags. So you understand what I mean?
Yes.
So they don't know whether people are defeated or not. So I think that this, I want you to read Desmond Morris, because I think that's a zoological perspective on technology, that is, on the influence of technology on human beings. As I say, it's a classic, but still worth reading, you know, for you at this stage, because it's, that is, his ideas are still very pertinent and, you know, that is very challenging. The history of perceptual adaptation to technology is a history of training of the senses that resemble the training of athletes. We have been training our senses, ladies and gentlemen, to adapt to technology. It's like the training of athletes. A series of performances, tests, competitions, tasks that incorporate the technical apparatus onto the individual and the collective body. That's why you have, for instance, if you take a Chinese or a Korean kid, that is, he is going to, to beat, a Moroccan kid in the use of technology very, you know, very easily. That's because, again, of the historical training of the senses. So we have a series of performances, tests, and competitions and tasks that incorporate the technical apparatus onto the individual and the collective body. Adaptation of the sensory organs to the new rhythms of perception, exercising and schooling perception to establish an equilibrium between human beings and the medium. The conclusion we must draw from this historical analysis of medium in Benjamin is clear. The term apparatus is not merely a technical apparatus, nor a form of representation, nor a means of communication, but implicates the organization of perception by technical mediums, a space where the material, cognitive, and discursive mediation occurs. Now we move to define the concept of aura and authenticity in Benjamin's project. Try to explain these terms and that is shed light on their different, you know, meanings. There are two opposite levels on which works of art are appreciated. Two opposite levels on which works of art are appreciated. One level centers on the cult ritual value of the artwork. The cult ritual value of the artwork. The other is on its exhibition value. So we have two different values. We have the cult, or let's call it cult or ritual value, and then we have the exhibition value. The first level, this cult ritual value, has to do with the aura, the aura of the work of art. That is the original auratic work. I give an example here to understand the ritual value of an auratic work. An authentic piece of painting. What is it appreciated on a piece of painting like for instance by Leonardo da Vinci? Where is it going to be appreciated? Museums and galleries. It is present in time and space. It has a unique existence where it happens to be produced. And when the artists or the elite go there to see it, to explore it, to analyze it, they need some mental effort, concentration, contemplation. So this all involves the ritual value, this cult ritual value. Why do we say cult? Because the appreciation of Leonardo da Vinci's work of art is not given to anyone, but it's given to the cult of the artists, of the elite, of the intellectual. You understand what I mean? That's why we use the word here, cult ritual value of the work of art. The second level has to do with reproduction of a work of art. It is the transition incurred by technologies of reproduction that emancipate, and here I quote a phrase by Benjamin, technologies of reproduction that emancipate the work of art from its parasitical dependence on ritual. From its parasitical, that is, dependence on ritual. So like there is as if ritual or aura exists in a that is in a parasitical form. Why does he say this? Why is it an emancipation of the work of art from its parasitical dependence on ritual? Because it's going to be yes? Very good. That's it. It's going to be available to the masses. That's it. Public. It's going to be. Sure, there is. It may lose its authenticity, and also there is its auratic value. Good. That's right. As Benjamin argues, these technologies of reproduction liberate the work from the restrictions of ritual context, and they transgress the boundaries of time and space. Which means that the work of art no longer has to exist in a particular time and space, like the authentic piece of painting in a particular museum. So mechanical reproduction emancipates the work of art from its parasitical dependence on ritual. It even deconstructs, as your friend says, originality. To a larger extent, the reproduced work of art becomes the work of art designed for reproducibility. Take an example of a photographic negative. From a photographic negative, for example, one can make any number of prints. So what is the original? To ask for the authentic or the original print makes no sense. So when authenticity ceases to exist in artistic production, the total function of art is reversed. Instead of being based on ritual, it begins to be based on politics. Why politics? Because the unit of measurement of art is no longer aura, but marketing. How should reproduction guarantee mass consumption? Art becomes appreciated for its exhibition value. As a consequence, the unique, authentic work of art is no longer the criterion for its production. The new technologies of reproduction that Benjamin refers to are photography and film. They exemplify art's new function. They mark the transition of art's reception from cult value to exhibition value. This transition brings the decline of auratic history, or what Chiel van den Acker names the historicizing gaze of art. I will come back. I will also recommend you this article to read, very important. Many of the ideas I've included in this lecture here by Sheel Vandenacker. He names the liaison, this operatic history, as the historicizing gaze of art. Reproduction is not authentic, and history depends on the unique work, not on its reproducibility. So a reproduced object of art cannot make the work's history. Reproduction may have a history of its own, but it's not the history of the unique work of art. Reproductions, as I said last time, those things that you feel are ambiguous to you, you just put questions there so that we discuss them in the session. I say a reproduced object of art cannot make the work's history. Reproduction may have a history of its own, but it's not the history of the unique work of art. Reproductions do not determine the original work's history. Its history is determined by the original artwork itself. If reproduction doesn't make history of art, and the revolution of technology has led ever since the beginning of the 20th century to the decline of originality, and the historicizing gaze is no longer functional in the reception of art, then it's the end of history. It's the end of the oratic age, a demise of authenticity. This end of history thesis foreshadows the emergence of the image in contemporary informational societies. So when we said in the title, the end of history, we mean the end of the oratic age, the end of the history of authenticity. Because history is not built on reproduction, it's built on originality of the work of art. Let's shed light on the concept of aura here. The end of history thesis shows well that aura is not an inherent property. So if we say it's the end of history, therefore aura is not an inherent property of art. It's not innate in art. It's a historical category. It's a community of elite. Remember Leavis when he calls the guardians of the intellectual archive. These guardians of the intellectual archive are the ones who bestow the aura on works of art. So it's historical. And each, you know, intellectual epoch has its own criteria for that is the aura of art. The end of history thesis shows well that aura is not an inherent property of art. It's a historical category, something which art acquires at a particular historical moment. It freezes a particular style of art appreciation, a particular way of art reception in time. Because each, as I say to you, each historical epoch has its own style of art appreciation. Le plaisir du texte, or theories of reception that appeared in the 20th century, they were not famous, or they were not predominant in the 19th century. Benjamin introduces his much celebrated notion of aura in the context of discussing authenticity. He identifies the aura of a work of art with its uniqueness and asserts the following, and these are his words. That which withers in the age, wither, it means dies, or that is evaporates or vanishes. That which fades away in the age of mechanical reproduction is the aura. That which withers in the age of mechanical reproduction is the aura of the work of art. And for the technique of reproduction detaches the reproduced object from the domain of tradition. So for Benjamin, aura is a retrospective historical category, like authenticity. It belongs to our understanding of the artwork rather than to the artwork itself. It's not an inherent property of art, but a set of meanings and symbols emanating from the encounter of the historicizing gaze and the artwork. One of Benjamin's critics, Costello, writes, aura is best understood as a predicate pertaining to the subject rather than to the object of perception. Aura is best understood as a predicate pertaining to the subject rather than to the object of perception. So who initiates aura? It is the subject of perception. It describes how that subject is capable of encountering its object. Another critic says, Douglas Davis contends that the aura doesn't reside in the thing itself, but in the originality of the moment, of seeing, hearing, or reading. Aura manifests itself in the originality of the moment of seeing, hearing, or reading. But we come back again to Van den Acker. Van den Acker says it's not a question of seeing, hearing, or reading alone. The aura only comes into being as a result of an attentive gaze, an attentive look, an attentive vision that involves contemplation, concentration, rather than the moment of seeing, hearing, or reading. So the aura comes into being in the contemplative encounter with the work of art. In other words, there is no aura outside consciousness. Unique artworks have an aura only as the result of contextual evaluation, their use, value in tradition and ritual. The museums and galleries provide this reminder. In other words, it's the historicizing gaze that identifies the aura of art. Then mechanical reproduction makes this historicizing gaze superfluous. Mechanical reproduction makes this historicizing gaze superfluous. It's the historicizing gaze that vanishes, that ebbs away in the age of mechanical reproduction, while involving shifts in perceptual modes. So, if the historicizing gaze vanishes, what is the substitute in the age of mechanical reproduction? Entertainment. Hypnoticism. Cultivating dysfunction. Who will come? That is to answer this question. Now we come to authenticity. Authenticity too is a historical category. The work of art becomes authentic at some moment in its lifetime, after collecting historical appreciations during its existence, which refers to the fact that the work's authenticity is identical to its historicity. Historicity is not the sum total of an existence in time, extending backwards into the past and possibly forwards into the future. Historicity is a career of existence. When we say historicity, it's not just a flux of time, or there is a time continuity from the past to the future. It's a career of existence, marked by the testimony of time, craftsmanship, symbolization, meaning, changes of ownership, and other marks of history. There are historical markers here. Historical markers that brand the work of art. The work of art is historically significant by retrospectively relating it to other objects and events. I'll give you an example. Thomas Hardy, one of the famous novelists of the 19th century in Britain. Think of Thomas Hardy, who became, or Thomas Hardy's work, which became authentic, most strikingly, so until 50 years after his death. The man died claiming he was a poet, rather than a novelist, because of the poor appreciation of his work during his lifetime. The authenticity of his work is going to, that is, emanate to the surface only, that is, posthumously, after many years after his death. Authenticity is a historical category, an attributed property of art at a specific period in time. Works of art are not only works of art not only acquire authenticity as time goes by, rather it's a feature of art especially celebrated in the 19th century modes of perception, of reception. Benjamin traces the historical change from the work of art reproduced to the work of art manufactured for reproducibility, for there is a difference between the unique work of art and its mechanical reproduction. For instance, in the case of photography or film, as we said, there is no original. When you produce a film or a photograph, you produce these from negatives. So there is no original. They are made for reproducibility. In the context of art made for reproducibility, originals and their reproduction do not make sense. The work's historical substantiality ceases to matter, and authenticity is no longer a criterion for artistic production. When this happens, the aura of the work fades away, and art's parasitical dependence on ritual comes to an end. Benjamin's central contribution is that the advent of the new technologies of reproduction has reversed the total function of art. First, art has increased in amount and quantity with reproduction. It is spread among larger segments of the population. The ritualistic or cult value of the work of art is replaced by its exhibition value. That's number two. So first, reproducibility has increased the amount and quantity of the works of art, because it becomes available for the public, as your friend says, or for the masses. It's spread among large segments of population. Second, the ritualistic or cult value of the work of art is replaced by its exhibition value. We are no longer speaking about the cult ritual value, we are now speaking about the exhibition value of the work of art. The appreciation of the exhibition value of art doesn't happen in museums and galleries. We don't need museums or galleries anymore to appreciate, you know, this erratic work of art. There are new spaces created by the technology of reproduction. What are these new spaces? Cinemas, internet, albums, television, different, you know, spaces where the exhibition value takes place, or where there is this exhibition of reproduced art work takes place. So the exhibition value cleaves art from the exhibitions in museums and galleries. It's finished. They've changed, that is, into new contexts of exhibition. Art intended for reproducibility is typically the art designed for the masses to consume. The art intended or designed for reproducibility is typically the art designed for the masses to consume. With the album, with the magazine, with the radio, with the television, with the cinema, and so on and so forth. With the internet, the masses become closer to art. It's no longer a trick to the elite, locked in galleries and museums. Now, art is spread to the masses to consume. The age of mechanical reproduction has broken the barricades of elitism of art. But the mode of perception has witnessed a shift. It's no longer contemplation. That's the problem now. So there is this contemplation and concentration and cult ritual practice that we have in museums and galleries is lost. All this work is lost. All this work, all these workings of the mind are lost. The mode of perception during the age of mechanical reproduction has witnessed a shift. It's no longer contemplation, it is entertainment. The viewer in the past who used to actively consume the works of art, the work of art, exercising his full senses and using his consciousness, now is almost hypnotized by the work of art. It lulls his senses to numbness. Like in action films, Hollywood action films. It lulls his senses to numbness. And here we are back to, you know, F.R. Leavis and also Dorothy Leavis speaking about, you know, that is masturbatory Hollywood films. Narcotizing the senses, overwhelming the viewer with dense description and manipulating his or her perceptual framework. It's the decline of concentration and erratic history of art. Benjamin, in his famous article on mechanical reproduction, argues that mechanical reproduction destroys the whole idea of authenticity based on the idea of the unique singularity of the object. As we have seen before, in a photographic reproduction, the negative can reproduce several prints, so to ask for an original doesn't make sense now. Close-ups? Let's take the example of some cinematic techniques or film techniques and see that is their effect on our perceptual skills. Close-ups, focus, rapid or slow motion, camera position, snapshots, supernatural effect, and other film techniques, they all make us rediscover our trivialities and familiar space in a mode of defamiliarization. All these film techniques that are used when describing just a trivial scene They make you this rediscover it again in a very, that is, from a strange perspective, in a defamiliar manner. We rediscover our realities in entirely new structural formations. All that is invisible to the naked eye becomes visible to the camera. The space that we live in unconsciously is rediscovered as a newly explored space of which we become conscious. And I want to give examples with my own experience, with my lectures, as an example. Of course, to my lectures there is an original, yes or not? Where, what is this original? The original is the lecture we live in the class. But the one reproduced on YouTube reveals to me entirely new aspects of my bodily and sensory experiences. Also, when I listen to my recorded self, or when I watch my recorded self, I become aware of my strengths and weaknesses and attempt to amend, correct, modify, improve the quality of my lectures and adapt myself to this new perceptual mode. Speaking to a small audience in class and sharing some readings and explanations is not like recording yourself lecturing to a massive audience. That needs not just collective reading and presenting, you know, explanations in class, but needs preparing lectures, prior readings, stating references, and a lot of hard work. So we are shifting the work into an exhibition value. To be honest with you, when I watch myself speaking, I'm shocked how the camera intervenes with the resources of my body, my gestures, and my facial expressions, my bodily movements, the rhythm of my voice. The camera introduces me to the unconscious optics of my actions. I've never paid attention to them. You understand? Viewing myself from a defamiliar position, that's an opportunity to improve reproducible performance. And this, of course, you can also do, you know, that is, and you can also experience yourself, and you will grasp what I mean here. Finally, what is the criticism we can level at Benjamin's project? I think more or less it is the same criticism that we level to, you know, previous critics of media studies. One of the unexplored areas in Benjamin's media theory is the delimitation of the human subject. The delimitation of human subject. What does he mean by the human subject? While speaking about the shift in perceptual modes in the age of mechanical reproduction, the reception framework is still considered generic. This reception framework Benjamin speaks about is a little bit generic, without contextual specificities attributed to a human subject position. Benjamin treats change in sensory experience as inevitably historical, but human, not social. So the question is, are we human organs or also social organs? Do we experience sensory mediums in the same way, with the same degree? Are we structured in the same way, irrespective of social contexts? Do we order the information in our minds in the same way, again, irrespective of discourses and contexts? Are we exposed to the same discourses? So how are we to link the generic concepts presented by Benjamin to the contextual variables of gender, age, race, social class, ethnicity, and other factors? Thank you. Let me remind you of the references where you can read further the issues in this lecture. Primary reference, The primary reference, of course, is Benjamin's The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction. Benjamin's The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, translated by Harry Zahn. And there is, as I said before the beginning of the lecture, there is a thoroughly revised translation of this version now available. The title is The Work of Art in the Age of Its Technological Reproducibility. The Work of Art in the Age of Its Technological Reproducibility, translated by Zahn, again, by Harry Zahn and Edmund Jeffcott. Okay, Harry Zahn and Edmund Jeffcott. Okay. So you have Harry Zahn and Edmund Jeffcott. Then we have other references. I mentioned before Antonio Sommeini, Walter Benjamin's Media Theory, that's the title of his article. Walter Benjamin's Media Theory, The Medium and the Apparent. The Medium and the Apparent. I'll repeat again. Walter Benjamin's Media Theory, The Medium and the Apparent. Another article by Sjeel van den Acker, he's a Dutch critic, Benjamin, The Image and the End of History. Benjamin, The Image and the End of History. Sjeel van den Acker. Okay. It's already written on the board, Acker. Benjamin's Aura, another article. Benjamin's Aura by Miriam Bratu Hansen. Miriam Bratu Hansen. Benjamin's Aura. And just a review, you know, a very small review of 7 pages by Andrew Benjamin. He's an Australian philosopher. Andrew Benjamin. The title of this review is The Decline of Art, Benjamin's Aura. The Decline of Art, : you know, Benjamin's Aura. Thank you.